Welcome to the Self-Consciousness Podcast. I am your host and guide, intuitive consultant, Jennifer Way, and I'm just so happy that you're here. Thank you for being a listener over the years, multiple. And if you're new to the Self-Consciousness Podcast, I love talking about spirituality. I also love talking about other stuff. Plainly, I just love talking. So I imagine my excitement when I get to bring on amazing hosts who also have podcasts and are amazing talkers. That is our episode today. Today, I have very special guest, Ophira Eisenberg. She is a writer, a comedian, an actress. She's written books. She's been on The Moth. She hosted a show on NPR. So many things. If you don't know her, you should. She is one of the most hilarious voices in comedy today, and I am just so grateful that she took some time out of her busy tour schedule to sit and talk with us. So join us for a really fun conversation. We talk about performance, we talk about comedy as per usual. We also talk about things that really piss us off. This is my favorite part of a conversation. So sit back, relax, and really, just come on in and enjoy. If you're not watching this podcast, that's okay. You can listen to it. We're having the audio version out there as well. But you can also check out our YouTube channel and our Spotify account to watch us in person. So I really hope you enjoy this. If you do, please rate and review and definitely subscribe to our podcast. I'm so excited to be able to bring these things to you and to share it with you. And I thank you so much for listening. Welcome to the Self-Consciousness Podcast, Ophira Eisenberg.
Thank you.
Woo! Big round of applause.
Thank you.
Very nice. You're a comedian, writer, actress. I mean, mother. How and...
I feel tired. I feel tired as you say this. Pick a lane, Eisenberg. Pick a lane.
Don't ever pick a lane, please. But
the world wants you to pick a lane. But I hear you. It's actually, that's not true. The world is like, well, what are you? And just focus on that. And then the reality is, could you also be a photographer, video editor, content creator, unbelievable marketer?
Yes.
And fill a club on a Monday night at 11 without any of us having to do anything.
Yeah. But pick a lane, seriously.
But pick a lane.
And you're your own one woman production company. Get it. But still, like, you know, also yeah, all these other things.
It's hilarious. We live in a weird, wild time. And that's me sounding optimistic.
That's like the good way to say it. I'm right there with you. I would love to know. This is just kind of like, you know, what would you say looking back? Like, what was your kind of big break?
I think I'm looking forward to that.
Seriously? Because to someone like me, like, I'm just like, wow, what was the path?
I don't think there was one singular event, honestly. But because it wasn't like, oh, and then I got, you know, from a monetary point of view, I would say, there was something around the time of me starting to do it, really stand up adjacent. I started to do stuff with The Moth, and I found how much I loved that storytelling world, and just having, I had written all of this stuff over the years that was longer form or really like a little bit more conversational. And I could not figure out ways to wedge it into stand-up for a thousand reasons. One was it wasn't particularly the style at the time. Like now we do, a lot of people like storytelling in stand-up. Yeah. But that was not happening in the early 2000s in New York when I was doing stand-up. It was super joke, 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 joke. And I didn't know where to put the stuff. So then there was this whole other world that I got into that was just building. Mm. So I have never really, everything I've ever done in my life, I've started when everyone's like, interesting time to start, when it's dying.
Yeah.
Everything. Always like a late adopter. Or yeah, even when I started stand up, it was like in the late 90s and everyone was like, no, everyone hates stand up. That was like really a time.
That was a rough time.
I was in I was in Canada, but I mean, like getting a friend to come to a comedy club, like they would just look at me like disgusting. Like they thought those my circle was like, we don't go to comedy clubs.
What was your
So,
interest
I
in
mean, they're not
comedy?
wrong. They're not wrong.
What was your,
I think I
like,
just like, yeah, I had this, I think I had a desire to perform. I think I had a desire to, honestly, like, this sounds way too emotionally charged, but it was like there was some story inside of me that I felt I needed to get out there. And I wanted to choose a medium. I love writing, but there was something about verbal, just very verbal. I do think I always kind of got the feedback, especially as I became a teenager, that I was the funny one. And honestly, I didn't like it. That was not very, I wanted to be attractive and sexy and all these other things. But that, so as a woman, you don't really get great feedback on that to go like, oh, keep going.
wow, you're so funny.
Funny. Yeah. I mean, like, this is a well-trodden territory. So I'm not saying something new, but I think we can all agree that if you are on any dating apps, all the women are that are heterosexual, all the women are looking for a guy with a sense of humor. No man is ever looking for that.
That's not
No
the
man.
number one.
Yeah. Maybe there's a few out there now that have adopted a higher sense, but, for the most part, like, really do not be funnier than me. But even just the idea of taking up that kind of space in conversation for a woman, like we're still clawing at that space. So, and I love doing things that are impossible. So I picked stand up, and then a few years after giving that a go in Canada, I moved to the States, and I would say, right, the storytelling thing was just. It really invigorated me, and I think it made me such a better stand-up because first person storytelling forces you to be yourself because that's what the audience expects. They don't want to hear a character. They don't want you behind. They don't want you to be defensive, like a joke can be a defense mechanism. You can still be funny, but it's a little bit of a different quality. And I think I was so swimming around trying in my stand-up to be, I was like, maybe I should be madder. Maybe the audience would like it if I was angrier. Maybe the audience would like it if I was like, I had more of like, I just seemed like this fun single gal. Like I was searching for this category to put myself in, which I still think would be great to find that. But instead, the storytelling just made me go, you just tell it like it is. And I think that, so, big break. I think everyone wants to hear. I went into this audition and I got the thing, and then everything changed. I would say artistically, the big break for me, which informed how I was moving forward, was finding, unlocking that little key. And then that was allowing me to go like, oh. And then I started getting work in both things. And then I had all these stories. And after, actually, it was a moth show, a lit agent is, and it was not the first time I had a lit agent in my life, but the right lit agent approached me and we started working together. And I published a book with that person's guidance and shepherding the marketing aspect of it. And then I got that job at NPR, and that was sort of that. I mean, that was great from a whole different point of view. I wouldn't say it's so funny because the NPR job hosting what was like a comedic but a quiz show, really almost took me out of the mainstream comedy scene because they did not
That's
share an
understandable.
audience at all.
I mean, I knew who you were from Ask Me Another. I mean, that's how
Yeah.
I knew your
So
name. I was
just
like,
like
oh.
nobody, it's like still to this day, there's an occasional person, but it's pretty rare someone in a stand-up club. Just so interesting how these things are so segmented. I didn't expect it that some person in a standard New York, let's just go with that, stand-up comedy club goes, I know you for that. There'd be one or two, but you'd think with a product, it would be a lot. And it just, it's a totally different audience.
Yeah,
And
I
then it's
learned
an
that.
older audience. I mean, I think public radio is always bashing its head against the wall trying to figure out how to bring in a younger audience, but it still is catering to an older audience. So sometimes I would have these really cool people coming up to me and they would go, "Oh my God, my dad is gonna freak out when he finds out I met you." I'd be like, "Oh."
And thank you. That's
It's
what I
like
was,
the
that's what I meant to
always,
do.
always hard, the compliments. So,
Yeah.
yes.
So you've really kind of mastered this different audiences and different formats. I mean, to sort of find yourself or what that sort of like little key was, what would you say kind of went into that little key? So it was really the format of the moth storytelling, and then it was just like understanding you really have to be thoroughly yourself. Is
Yeah, I mean,
that,
I
would you
think it
say,
was
the key?
trusting. Yeah, I think it
Trusting.
was trusting. For me, it was trusting that who I was as an actual person was worthy of people hearing it, that I didn't have to find a different something to put myself in or wear a special outfit or it was just like, you know what? Just double down on this. Like the first time I told a succession of stories, it took a little while for me to agree that this was a valid lane, because I'll never do anything once and be like, oh, they'll be like, well, that was just lucky, because I'm whatever diagnosis you want to give me is fair. It was so it took a few, and I always felt it was just really going like, oh, what I write when I'm just being me is people like it, so I have to do that
Yeah.
instead of pretending. I think I was pretending or writing from the point of view, which we all do. It's not necessarily not anything new, but writing from the point of view of what you think the audience wants to hear, what they want to see, who you would like to be. And this isn't applicable so much to stand up, but in the storytelling world, I think when you're being your authentic self, overused words, which sometimes is you're usually telling the story from your past, obviously. And you have to admit that you're not doing revisionist history. So if you were the worst version of yourself, if you said something that now you look back and you're like, oh my God, and you maybe in telling that story to friends, family, or maybe in your head, you rewrote it a little bit to be a shinier version of yourself, because that would be so much more palatable. But if
Yeah.
you wipe that away and go back, that is often where the audience attaches, because we all know what it's like to do that, and the emotion of being wrong or failing and all of that, and not just
Or
rising like
shamed.
a triumphant phoenix from the ashes.
All the ugly steps along the way, the ugly steps that normally would hide away.
Yeah, and I'm just slightly hesitant as I'm saying this because I
Oh,
by
yeah.
no means, because we live in a weird world
Oh,
now,
yeah.
by no means I want anyone to listen to this and go, oh, so the hate I feel towards another culture, I should just double. No. I'm not talking about that
Be your
ugly person.
true racist,
Yeah, not that.
anti-Semitic,
Yeah, exactly. That's
self.
no. I just
Yeah,
mean the
it's not a
true
license.
human emotions.
Yeah, and that's the thing. It's like, but we are so used to presenting ourselves in a certain way. I mean, I think sort of along
Yes.
the lines of that diagnosis, which of course is just like a whatever word. It's just a word to kind of fit into the system that we've created. It doesn't mean like I'm talking about like neurodivergence versus like neurotypical, like whatever that
Yeah.
category is. A lot of a lot of the reasoning that comes so late is because people who've missed out being diagnosed have masked. So that was a word I learned this year. And I was like, oh,
Yes.
that's like literally what I am. I'm made up of multiple people who had mannerisms or gestures that I thought were like cool. And I like remember as a child, like layering up. So this process of like learning that was like delayering, but I'm like performing, you really have to get to such a raw state of who you are. And I think being presented with an idea of like being on stage, which I haven't really done, it's not what I do.
But I'm like, I've been performing for 48 years. I'm just very tired. So I'm like, I wouldn't even know where to start going up and really kind of like affecting people with the truth, because I feel like
It's still, I mean, it's an ongoing challenge, honestly. It's an ongoing, and it changes all the time, because who you, hopefully, I do believe you change as life moves forward. And so then you have to rejigger what it is about you that you want to put out there. And I was talking to some comedian pals of mine about how much I wish, because you step on stage and the audience looks at you, and some people out there have these great, you know, little bit hacky, but great jokes where they go, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, you know, oh my God, the IT guy finally showed up. Or you're thinking, is that Robert De Niro? I'm, you know, mixed with, there's always two celebrities mashed together or something like that. And then the audience goes, hey, and it sort of relaxes them because there's this connection. And I've never had that. I've never walked on the stage and thought and had that perfect little like, I was mentioning, you know, don't I look like this and this combo? And then everyone goes, hooray. And then you move on. And so, but my friend was like, why does it have to be two? Why can't you just be like, don't I look like this and this and that with a little bit of this minus this plus that? And I was like, that is so funny to me to just do a list, but the it would be lost at an audience. They would just be like, what is going on, right?
Trying to get like everyone's perspective in there.
And just how ridiculous that is. How it's like, but it is I know speaking, that we love categories.
Yeah, we true. We want to identify things. We want to feel a little power over them because we're so disempowered in daily life. Thanks, government. Thanks, patriarchy. Thanks, everything. But yeah, it's just like a little bit of power. I mean, I think like I used to love going to comedy shows in the early 2000s. Well, I used to go to, did you ever do Eating It at Luna Lounge on Monday nights?
So when I first moved here, that was the show, and I say New York, that was the show I wanted to do, because I think I hit it in the tail end. I didn't know that at the time.
Yeah.
Like I say, I always hit things right as they're closing.
Me too.
And it seemed very cool. And I hung out at it immediately. And I did get on it, I think, a handful of times. But and I was always so nervous when I got on it, even though it was supposed to be the show where you could eat it. But it turned into the show to see cool people.
It really was.
I wanted to be on it.
Yeah. I used to love going to that show. I miss Luna Lounge. Luna Lounge became sort of my mainstay in the early 2000s. I was I was always just an observer. I was never like a performer. I was more of like a groupie. I don't know.
Great people going up. I mean, there was great stuff happening.
I saw
there.
Janine Garofalo. Yeah. I saw Dave Chappelle.
All the time.
Yeah. It was really amazing. Such a great time. Yeah. I feel like, especially in New York, if you know people kind of being in the same thing and the same, there's just such a vitality to it. I feel like that's happening with comedy a little also at this time. Do you feel like that? I just feel like it's so saturated.
I was just, because I'm right now doing this, I feel so separated from everything because I've been in Canada, my homeland, for basically 3 straight weeks doing this wacky corporate tour for money. That's
awesome.
Why I do these things, people.
Hell yeah.
But I feel completely separated from New York. But I'm with another comic who is fantastic, and he's performed all over. And I was saying he started in the comedy boom of the 80s. So I only knew about that. I obviously never participated. I don't even know if I wasn't even like going to comedy clubs at that point. I wasn't even drinking. I was just maybe drinking age at the very end of it. So, and I said, do you think the comedy boom now is like the comedy boom then? And he said, I think there's a lot of people right now that want to see comedy, but the money's not there. Which is true. Like in the 80s, you hear this thing where, you know, someone who is just new or just a what we call a feature act or a middle act which is someone that is still starting out and not the headliner, but you could tour the country and make a great living in that position.
That's true. So. I have a good friend, Karen Rontowski. She's been doing it for 30 years. And she's just finally, well, not finally, but she's been doing it. She's not a huge, you know, she was on, I think, like Letterman back in the day, but she's doing a psychic stand-up show where she reads tarot and does like crowd work with the tarot, but also like straight stand-up. But she's doing that's a lot fun. Of the corporate gigs. I mean, that is where the money is. And she said that someone, a younger person who basically came up to her and was like, that's my plan. That's what I want to do in 5 years. She's like, honey, she's like, it took 30 years for me to be able to build this so that I can go to maybe being flown out to like Dubai or something like that. I mean, it's like, it's not, you know, it's not going to take 2 seconds.
And good for her for cracking the corporate thing too, because as much as we feel like the corporate world is I don't know, a place where, you know, you're like, oh, there are more women in leadership, and I think there's a lot of press about like the female CEO here and the woman who's ahead of that, but my experience is a lot of corporations are still very male dominated, very male heavy, and if they do comedy, they like the idea of bringing in a woman to be the one stand up at their corporate event is like, that's a risk.
I don't know why I'm laughing at this, because I'm just like, doesn't the world see this, that it's all bullshit, this whole sort of like I used to work in corporate, so I worked for Bertelsmann. Bertelsmann is a German, it was like me and like three other Jews were like, why are we here? These people were literally Nazis. Like they the family that owns Bertelsmann, it's a privately owned company. They own RTL. They own Fremantle Media. That does all the like America's blah, 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 blah. They own Penguin Random House. They own BMG. They're huge, but they're like decentralized. But I worked in corporate HR, of course, because that's what you do. It's basically like a corporate bartender. That's what I was. It was like a, let me listen to your stories, but let me also fucking run your payroll. No, but it was very, it was all lip service, this whole idea of equality. I watched women killing themselves for 10 years just to get finally a VP. And then they would like import all these like young German dudes who would come in, and within 3 years, they were like barely 30. Within 3 years, they'd be VP. And it was just so there, like, hello, like,
it's so obvious.
It's so obvious to me.
Yeah,
and I also was trying to get sacred comedy as a comedy show into a corporate wellness program with not
great
a
idea.
Lot of success. It's a great idea.
Keep going.
But like,
keep
I'm gonna
going,
yeah,
that.
I've yeah, I did one of those like big, I'm gonna write an email to like everybody I know, everyone I've ever met, because I know a lot of random people around the world, you know, and I got like three answers. Not, you know, but it's like, I know I have to keep going, but I'm also like, I'm tired.
I know it's like, hard. And that kind of work is that sending emails and following up and the diminishing returns. It is so like, what a mind.
Grueling.
Ugh, yeah. And you don't know, because we all get emails and we all feel inundated by emails and we all have best intentions. Sometimes we're like, oh, that's a not right now thing, because I've got this pile that's on fire, but interesting. And then 2 days later, you're like, what email? Where? Who? I don't know.
Yeah. And I have to remember that. That's the thing I have to kind of, I mean, a lot of, but I do think corporate is a great example of something that can change by adding things like comedy, things like wellness pro. I mean, I think
they're always asking for
they're
that.
They're wanting,
within.
They have a huge, I mean, everyone listen, like if you're in the wellness field, even if you're in a comedy field, I mean, they have huge budgets for this stuff.
They have
huge
budgets.
And they don't know where to put it, because they're not specializing in performers or healing or things like that. So they
no, and I think too, they still feel like comedy is like, it's so like, those are the people in it's it, there's an innocence that I miss actually in this world where people are afraid to speak. Like, public speaking is still people's number one fear. I do believe that just with
That's
the
so funny.
amount of public speaking that people are forced to do within their job and even in school, and then, you know, everyone has a camera in their face, like their phone, and they're recording their stuff, that people are much more comfortable with the idea of public speaking. But every once in a while, you meet that person that is like, goes beet red in the face just at the idea of getting, and
It's
I love those
true.
people. I'm like, oh my God,
You're so
you're right. This is
authentic.
hard. This is hard.
It is hard. I know, like, appreciate it, like, respect
Appreciate it.
it. That's the thing.
Yeah.
It doesn't really get, that's what I think when I started the whole sacred comedy thing, I was like, I really hated that it was just so disrespected by everybody. Not like, forget men and women. It was just like, it was just such a, let me sit back, get me drunk, feed me, make me laugh, go ahead. And then like, arms crossed. And it's like such an unforgiving thing. And I'm like, how do you, is it addicting? I mean, I hear that from people that it really is something that it's addicting. You get up on stage, you have a great night. When you have a great night, it's like, when can I go back up?
And you just keep going. Yep, I would say that is true. I also think, you know, at the deepest part of it, without the chemical, you know, reaction going through your body that makes you want to keep chasing that feeling, I do think that there, for me, the feeling of having a room of people of whatever size, doesn't matter, 12 people would be fine, that are like, I know what you're saying. I have felt that too. And that is funny. And we all laugh at it. To me, that is the thing I crave all the time. I crave that connection.
Yeah.
And I guess I crave it on a mass level.
And you're doing it. And you're
but
doing
it's a
it.
little bit of like cutting through the loneliness and cutting through the isolation of the world. Right. So,
and even
yes.
more so now. I mean, everyone's just gotten so good at doing their own thing. Do you feel like it's harder
Oh,
to get people
God.
out to shows these days? Like, say, pre-pandemic?
Of a certain age range, I think, I mean, right. I think the idea, because people work from home, so that energy is lost where people would be at the office all day, and then they would like maybe be like, hey, do you guys want to catch a show at 8? We'll do a drink or a snack, and then we'll head over. Like that kind of energy where you're just like, yeah, we're just doing this day, and then we'll go home, is lost, because then it's like, I haven't put on pants all day, and now at 6, I'm going to start that process. No.
You have
But
a, oh, yeah. Go ahead. Sorry.
I was just going to say, as my friend has said, we are so, we have to really respect and enjoy the audience that does come there, because those are mostly people that still are trying to get laid, and that those people will always need to get out.
You
and
have
then
a
I read
joke.
these articles that like no one wants sex anymore because we live in such a like sexless society. Not that,
Oh,
yeah,
yeah. And
it's
you can just
because
order sex on Amazon. Like, you can
right.
order it or Tinder or whatever. But like,
or whatever.
Also like dolls and things, and you never need another person again. Like, apparently.
Apparently.
I was going to say, like, you have a bit that I love about like your dream date is like someone asking you out, and then like the day of, they're like, I have to cancel. And you're like, yes. So fucking relatable. That's going to be this podcast, everybody. It's just going to be me repeating your jokes. That's what I usually do when I get like people I really admire on. I'm like, let me just tell you your joke poorly back to you.
That's so, actually, sometimes when people tell me my joke
I
back
love
to me,
that.
I'm like, oh, that's the wording I should have used. It's
Really?
like they say it in a way, yeah, that you're like, oh, yeah, that probably would make more sense.
That's always
So.
interesting to me about like what we're, I don't know if you have this with your husband, but I'll be like, remember when you said blah, 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 blah. And he's like, that's not what I said at all. I feel like I hear that all the time in my house. Nobody said that. I'm like, but I hear it. Like, I'm pulling. I feel like I'm
That's
really
cool. I
bad at
mean, right.
communicating these days. I don't even know where I am with that.
I think we all, there's a little, that's like that little filter trap in our brain where the stuff goes in And then I get mixed around, and then
Oh,
you're
yeah.
like, oh, that's what I heard.
Yeah, that's what I heard. I heard I'm useless, I'm ugly, and I'm fat. That's what I heard. Meanwhile, they were like, are you eating dinner? It's like so simple.
Call me that. What?
I know. I didn't hear. We'll move into this a little because you were also on episode 8 of our Sacred Comedy podcast, and you had a psychic reading with Nellie Resnick.
Yes.
And did it change any of your feelings? And I also wanted to hear updates about the show that you were planning because you talked a little bit about that show on the podcast. You were talking about kind of what the future would have looked like for that show. And I think it has to do with what happened to you as a kid. And
Oh
then I
yeah.
saw that you're doing it. You have been doing
Right.
it.
I have been doing it. So what did I
I
take away
asked you,
from
I
that?
didn't even
Well,
ask a question. I think I just
yeah.
spat on
So from
into the
the reading,
microphone.
I will tell you, so there was I mean I wrote a joke about it actually. I'm still fiddling with it, so it hasn't really hit where I need it to be. But it was the first
Yeah.
time in my life that there was a medium aspect. You know, I've seen psychics over the years, mostly in the like fun context,
Yeah.
nothing too serious. But that was the first time that there was a medium, and there was, you know, the idea that someone could talk to my dead parents.
Yeah.
And that was pretty interesting. Although what came out, I was like, I didn't really attach, like, I was just like, that's not really how it is. And then I
Yeah.
just think the idea of doing this over Zoom is, I don't even get it. But
Me neither.
I kept thinking about it and later, and I was like, what, you know, given the, I don't really want to talk to dead people.
Me neither. That's why I don't do
Only
mediumship. I hate
only
it.
because I'm a little bit like, can they just be dead? Like, do they really want to be like contacted so they can be like, Ophira, just try doing the solo show in a small space.
Just go to
See if
take
you
it to
can build an
Brooklyn.
audience. Like, are they done with my crap? Are they done with it?
They're
Can we
always
just let them
meddling.
go?
I
Like,
know.
just let them rest. Isn't
I
that what
love
this
that.
whole death thing is about?
I
And
love that.
then, you know, just from the point of view of a psychic, you know, there's this idea, and I think it was even presented there where it's like, bring in a couple questions or bring in, you know, something specific to make good use of the time. And I was like, what are the questions? And honestly, I just keep thinking it all, and I think I said it on that podcast, and I just kept thinking about it all kind of boils down to two things, like, soothe my anxiety. Is everything going to be okay? There's
Yeah.
just that. Like, just can you give me a blanket? Is everything going to be okay? So
Yeah.
subjective. Like, what even is that?
It's perfect.
But yeah.
It, I
And then
mean,
the
yeah.
other question would be, will the people who have harmed me suffer?
That's right. I remember
And that
that.
no one wants to,
Nobody wants to answer that.
they don't.
And I think like I can answer. Let me
And I was
take
like,
a
why can't you
stab
do
at it.
revenge? Why can't you
I
do
know.
revenge in
You
reading?
can do
Anyway.
revenge, and this almost involves a little bit of witchcraft, which the rule is like
Ooh.
whatever you put out is going to come back to you. So if you're putting out something that is asking for the suffering of another person, whatever, you know, like everyone's got their own shit sort of, and but they can make you suffer in the process. Maybe they don't realize they're making you suffer, but are they going to experience that suffering back? Almost always, yes. If not in this lifetime, definitely another lifetime. There's something that, and I don't know if I said that in that podcast, but the general sort of idea with afterlife, and this is consensus from like psychics and mediums and things like that, is that
Yeah.
you have a sort of life review once you pass over. So once you transition, because we like to say that takes the, listen, I became a psychic because I wanted to know I could talk to my dead relatives. That was literally, I was like, I
Really?
was so attached to my mom at the time. And so, and like kind of attached to my, sort of attached to my dad. I love my dad, whatever. But like, you know, I was like, I want to know that I can talk to them after they're gone. Like death is too painful. And then I had also had like close friends who'd passed. And, you know, I was just like, I just want to know. It's funny. A blue jay just always at the right time, Mr. Blue Jay. comes right to my window. Oh, anyway,
I love it.
He's just looking for a place to put his fucking peanut. I really hate it. Anyway, ADHD. So you have this life review. Sorry. You have this life review. And what I've heard, and people with near-death experiences have also sort of provided the same kind of information, which is you get a feeling of the way you affected every person in your life. You almost feel it. I mean, obviously not physically, out of body, where you're experiencing the feeling you were responsible for giving another person. So they will kind of get, they have to experience all of that. You know, like, for example, when my mom first died, I was too much in a grief state to really talk to her. I thought I would be like, oh, cool, I don't have to grieve. I really did it just because I hate grief. Don't want it. Don't want to feel it. I'm a hugely anxious person. And I'm like, I don't want to have grief. No, let me be a psychic so I don't have to. Like, I thought I could sidestep grief.
Amazing.
Doesn't work that way because the grief puts you in such a weird state that you're not clear. And then you'll hear them because it's so recent. Because I had another friend pass away in June. Like, you hear them right away, but your mind is like, I'm making this up. This isn't real. So even if you know that you're a psychic, it's really confusing. And I have to be like, nope, please don't talk to me right now. But I worked with psychics who I trusted when my mom first passed over, and she was the one who was kind of like explaining it. Like, she kept kind of coming in the beginning because she was very, and she would come through in dreams and stuff and just be like apologizing for a lot of stuff. Oh.
Something just happened. Sorry.
Oh, no, that's fine. That's fine. That was my mom. That was my mom talking to your mom, being like, we should apologize. No. But yeah, so that's sort of the answer to like the suffering thing. It's like the people are always going to experience a little bit of what they did to you. And the unfortunate thing is we're going to experience that as well. Things that we didn't even remember that, you know, like affected someone or changed the course of their life or somehow changed their energy. But, you know, I think all that stuff is kind of meant to happen. Even the people who kind of make you suffer so that you're pushed into another place that you might not have gone without that experience.
That's very optimistic, which I like. I like that. And I vacillate a little bit with the idea of, you know, this, that kind of, to bottle it down.
Yeah.
You know, things happen for a reason. The good and the bad, things happen for a reason. And they push you places. Where it falls apart, I've had, and I think you have too, some very tragic, hard things happen to me and people in my life.
Yeah.
And sometimes when you're met with that verbiage, when that kind of stuff happens, you go, yeah, no, how dare you? How dare, how about, because sometimes I meet people and you're like, so, you know, whatever, you never asked this question, but what a great question is, what bad things have happened to you? And of course, everyone has lived a life or are living a life and, you know, nothing is easy, but you know, there are people out there in this privileged world I walk in where they've had pretty minimal scarring, to say the least. And like, God love them. I'm not saying, I hope life gets to you, because that's not it at all. But I just go, well, that sounds great. Why can't I have that?
Oh, yeah. It's boring.
You know what? Bring it on.
Great, bring boring. On the boring.
Bring it on.
I hear you.
Isn't that the joke that the greatest curse in the world is may you live an interesting life?
Yeah. You know what my kids are saying now? The Gen Zs, my daughter's almost 16. She's like, it's a character builder thing. It's building character. And I was like, is that like a Gen Z phrase that you've again commandeered from our existing language that you just came up with? And she's like, yeah, it's like such a thing that everybody says now. It's character building. I'm like, okay.
I remember being on stage about, got to be something like 10 years ago with a great comic still a great comic, continuing to be a great comic, Christian Finnegan. And it was, it was not ideal circumstances. I remember like the place wasn't great. The audience was small. Like there was just one of these things where you're doing a comedy show, but all of the things that are supposed to be in place for this to be a successful setting were not happening. And I think the first thing out of his mouth was, I am so sick of character building shows. And I was like, yeah. Sometimes you just want to be like, that was great.
Fucking sucks. Oh, I mean, I think what I like to think of is, at least what I've started to kind of embrace is, when it's dark, it's time to get in there. Fucking let's go as dark as possible. Because I think it's funny bringing really dark shit to people as much as possible. Because I feel like only when you've experienced that extreme or both extremes, it just makes you more of a whole person. And it doesn't mean this doesn't drag you down and this doesn't suck or anything, but it just means you've seen enough to know that there's a light side of the sphere and a shadow side of the sphere. It's just, that's where we are. That's the planet that we're on. It's always going to be night somewhere. It's always going to be day somewhere. So it's like, but the people who, and this is another thing, y'all. Okay. So please follow Ophira on social media. I'll leave all of her information down in the show notes. But one of the things that I love that you do, which is, it's like your thing. It's just that you find these positivity signs. I don't know this.
They're everywhere.
I don't even know how to. And then you write a sticky note like "fuck you" underneath, and it's just like, oh, it's just so perfect. Like everybody needs to see these all the time because it's like, you know, like we're like good vibes.
They're
only.
Everywhere.
Yeah,
they're everywhere. I feel like, was that post pandemic? Did it happen during? I feel like it happened post pandemic. Honestly, where all of a sudden I looked around. There always have been these signs. I think you can. By
you're like hang in there
sayings.
With the little kitten,
right?
Like,
it's
hate
like
Mondays,
successories
Kathy.
That was and then I think there was a world where, you know, even psychiatrists and therapists and life coaches probably were saying, you know, that idea, hey, write a bunch of really positive things on sticky notes and you put them on your mirror or something so you can see them every day to keep you affirmation. Exactly.
Yeah.
And I am not against any of that positive thinking. God knows I could use a dose of it. But then it crossed the line and became every Target, every Michaels, every home. Yeah. It became just this ridiculousness. And the idea, you know, that people would put art in quotes on their wall that was words to remind, you know, and I was like, oh, it's Orwell. Like on one level, if you told me that the government, I will get conspiratorial, this isn't true, but if you told me the government, too bad our government is like so messed up that, was like, this is, they're like, oh, these Americans, they're if we don't get them back up, they're not going to buy. We need them to buy. How do we get that capitalist spirit back in their soul? You know what? Positivity. They love positivity.
Toxic
they're all
positivity.
America's built on the pursuit of happiness, but they're not feeling it anymore because the economy's all messed up and the next generation is never going to afford real estate and the world is on fire and that's really going to impact buying. So what do? We got to work on positivity. We got to commodify positive.
We can
positivity.
Sell it with a specific font. That we only use the same font over and
over.
Over it's
and
like
over.
A script, but a little more formal.
Make it look organic a little bit, like whatever it's on. It's
weathered
it's
wood.
Repurposed spike. And they're going to eat it up.
I think it's like an Amazon. I mean, I feel like I remember seeing a lot of those in like Bed Bath & Beyond. Like if you'd go like the generic art section. And then but now the Bed Bath & Beyonds are closing down. But maybe it's like on, I don't know. Maybe it's the Etsy thing where everyone moved, like everyone stayed home and it's like, no, I make signs and I sell them on Etsy. Maybe it's like the crafting revolution or something. I don't know. But yeah, I'm with you. It's
and
so
then
stupid.
It turned very quickly. So now there are equal amounts, not in like a Target or a Home Goods, Home Sense. I forget what one version's in Canada, one version's in America. Home Goods, Home Sense. Anyways.
Oh, okay.
They're the same brand, but they tweak their name a little bit. or, you know, any of that kind of like, right, generic housewares all in one mega store, you're going to find these everywhere. But then in those stores that are just like one step boutiquier and cooler, they all have the reactions. So now there's a whole world of like just heavy amounts of cursing. Heavy amounts of cursing, heavy
it.
amounts of, and then some of them are a little still basic, like, you know, don't tell me to feel better. I just need a coffee kind of thing.
I know. I feel like there is a future in your sayings on top. Like I almost want a frame of like a post-it note. Like, you know what I mean? Like it's like floating with glass around it and then like the frame and it's just your handwriting. I feel like there's something you can do
Oh,
with that.
I like that. Oh, I
I
just
know.
should save all my post-its
Do you
and
remember,
put
did
them
you
on
ever
a
get the, you really should. I mean, I know they're all captured photographically, which is great. So there's the, that's the picture book. That's the next publication.
That's the picture book, absolutely.
See, I was like, it's so hard. I was like, I just had a thought in my head that I was going to ask you about. And like, it completely fucking flew out of my head because I get so excited. And I,
That's okay.
What the
Me too.
hell was it?
That
I
but
know.
that is that isn't a sign of anything other than like your brain has many great thoughts.
It
But
does. Oh, too
that's me
many.
being positive.
I know. Thank you. Thank you. I was going to say it, too much weed, but I've stopped with that. It's, you know, it's funny. I almost said guidance counselor. My psychologist was like, she's like, yeah, we've got all these like diagnoses, but your main thing, the thing that's just at the source of everything is anxiety. And I'm like, oh, okay. And she's like, now we just have to figure out what you're anxious about. I'm like, what am I not anxious about?
But yeah, where tell me what to relax on.
I was like, it's not only my life experience that makes me anxious and the whole world around me that makes me anxious. It's also all of the DNA in my body that makes me anxious. I'm like, I know stuff that's happened in my family's past that, I mean, there's a reason Jewish mother's Jewish mother. Like there's some real fucked up shit, you know? And I'm like that.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm sorry, but like when you're, I do think this, like when you're two and then you have a child, something turns on. It's just like,
Oh, big time.
yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I
That
mean,
anxiety is just, no, there's nothing I can do about it. I'm like, it's just here to stay.
yeah, and you know, I was thinking the other day because trauma, and then generational trauma, and then, you know, every time I'm in a therapeutic setting, we're just, you know, just focused on everything. I think I'm going to just go out on a limb and say everybody has a very a blanket of anxiety happening. And so it's just what level, how thick is your blanket? Okay. How thick is your weighted anxiety blanket? But I think that's a baseline. I really think anxiety is a baseline right now. And then what do you pack on top of it? So, you know, and where does it come from? So in my life, it's a, you know, from trauma that I experienced as a child. It's just like, you don't even, it's the lines are clear. But I always think it is ongoing trauma. We always talk about ongoing trauma. And I was like, so where's the, you know, where's the rhetoric out there? Where's the therapist out there that's just like, well, and then the trauma ended. Where is that? I would love that. But I feel, you know, and you might just think, well, that's impossible. It's an ongoing journey. Fair. You might also think that anyone that's trying to sell you that snake oil salesman, fair. But how about this? How about this? Being conspiratorial once again. How about why? Because it's easier to keep, I mean, what actually keeps people buying and searching is being told they're in a state of ongoing trauma.
Oh,
If it never ends,
yeah.
you always have to treat
You
it.
always have to treat it. Do you know? Or this is why I don't do what I do. This is why I don't push it out there because I found a lot of people like who were coming to me for psychic stuff. And I
Yeah.
was like, okay, I'm not a counselor. I'm not a psychologist. And I respect that boundary.
I'm sure you have to do so much of that.
But there's it, and it, but they are expecting me. They're like, okay, so what do I do? When do I see you next? I'm like, no, I'm not that person. I'm like, I only want to see you once. And I want to tell you what you need to hear right now, or at least what's coming through. But like, that's for you to take on. I mean, I was finding people really wanted to keep coming back. And I'm like, I'm not going to be that marketer. Like, I'm not going to be that person. Cause this is honestly, I would do this for free because it's like, my ideal job would be like a monk or like someone just going, living in a mountain, bring me food, help me take care of myself. And then I'll give you all the things that you need, like all the advice, all the psychic, whatever, you know,
it's I
like,
love that.
That would be my ideal.
Jennifer, attainable goal.
I know. I think so. I just got to fucking pay for 2 colleges. And after that, I'm clear. Oh, God.
Oh, that's nice that you're paying for 2 colleges.
I think that's the idea in the back of my head that's okay. Maybe the anxiety that I'm probably going to be like, guys, you got to get a job. You're not going to be paying for. And also on the last note, I'm like, I know we got to wrap up soon, but are you like, I know you're from Canada originally and you're officially a citizen here.
Yeah.
Would you ever go back? Like there's so many Americans who are like, you're so lucky.
I know. I'm here right now. I'm in Toronto, which is, you know, basically Toronto, Vancouver. Like there's a small number of big cities here. Canada's kind of funny because there's a small number of big cities here and then small towns. Like there's just less metropolitan centers than there are in America. Yeah. So it's where you're like, where would I move to is kind of slim unless you want a much more rural or small town experience. And you know, my husband and I talk about it all the time when we're looking at what happens in America. And it is interesting being up here because there is that it's just north of all of America. And it's, you know, with your eyes closed, maybe you wouldn't even know the difference. But there is a feeling like that they're laughing at us. Like the news is laughing at America. It, you know, what happens in America affects Canada 100%. And a lot of Canadians think that Canada falls in suit. So the more conservative America gets, the more conservative Canadian politics get. Like they're really in step. They're not as counter as you would think. And there's a lot of criticism here. Nobody wants to move to a privatized healthcare system, but they want access to it. Like there are some things that are talked about in a way that I go, oh, it's different. It's not different. But there is that feeling, for better or worse, of I can't, the only description I can give you is spongy walls here. Like there is this kind of feeling that if you fall down, someone's going to pick you up.
Oh God, I love that. That's
and
amazing.
It's interesting. I think from an artistic point of view, this sounds so crazy, but it's back in this full circular conversation. I think from an artistic point of view, sometimes that does not create the best art because I think, unfortunately, the tension creates the loudest reaction and sometimes the best art. I mean, I wish I could say that great art comes out of happiness and stability.
See, and there we are.
And I can't even say it without laughing. That would be amazing. But I think to create the art, to actually paint or write or whatever it is, you have to be at a stable-ish place to actually do it.
Yeah.
Or else you know, just clawing for survival makes it pretty hard to, you know, be like, and now I'm performing, which I think a lot of us know because, you know, when you're clawing for survival, it is, you're just trying to pay the rent, you know?
Yeah.
But so there's this feeling here, there's a little bit of an edge that is off, and it's interesting. Yeah.
That's freaking, well, it's great to hear that there's alternatives to ways of life, but not for any of us yet.
As someone who's lived in New York for now almost 20 years, I do, even in Toronto, I kind of walk around a little bit like, yeah, whatever, guys. I live in New York. Like, cute restaurant.
Nice graffiti. Whatever.
I do wear it, like, and I catch myself and I go, you're hilarious
Yeah.
thinking that it's like your ego is
I
built
mean,
on.
that's the New York effect. I mean, everything is stacked literally on top of one another so you can look down on everybody. Like, that's the whole energy, right? So it's like, really? That's a building? Oh, look at you. It's all 70 floors. Oh my gosh.
This is your public transportation system? Oh,
It's so
cute.
clean. Oh,
But I
geez.
did get on the Toronto subway, which runs perfectly fine. It just
Oh,
doesn't go
sure.
enough places. And I will say that there was a woman beside me who had bags all on three chairs. And I just looked at her like, what's that? What are you doing? What are you doing? And nobody else was. Very passive culture here. I will say that. Little of that British, just you think what you think inside, but God forbid you make the eye contact or get involved. And I was like, oh, I am dying to
Oh
say
yeah.
something to you.
Yeah, that's kind of why I love living in New Jersey, I have to say. I'm like, fuck you. Like, really, I'm like, I really get it all out. I'm so happy to just, I'm like, just call, come, just waiting for it. Come on.
Oh God,
I'm
I felt
almost,
that way.
I'm
Walking
so
around the streets
ready.
of Toronto, I was like, what's wrong with me that I'm like craving an altercation right now? I'm like, I'm ready. Who wants to say anything to me? Because I got something to say to you.
Oh my God. Can we form a gang? Like, I really would. I think just like women who were over 40, over, let's say over 45 at this point, like women who were over 45, we just need to, like, we just, I don't, they need to be scared of us now. Like, it's, we're at that
It's
point in
so
life.
funny you say that because there's all this, there's a lot of media. It's great. I think there's so much great stuff going out there right now, just being like catering to women over 40 or over 45. There's more stuff talking about all women's health issues, comedically, from an information point of view, all like where you're talking menopause, perimenopause, miscarriages, pregnancy, like what if fertility, whatever it is, all of it, all being thrown out there in a way that I hope it is big as it seems to be in my feed. My feed can be specific, obviously. So I hope that. But my friend, I just don't like the rhetoric where all these women who are a little bit women of a certain age or whatever umbrella term you want to say are like, and I've never felt sexier than ever. Because you know what, Jennifer? I don't want to. I don't. That's not what I aspire to. I want to feel threatening. That's what I want to feel at this age. I do not want the male gaze to be like, I would like to fuck her. I want them to be like, I am afraid of her. That's my goal.
Such a great goal. Achievable goals. I can't, I was telling people, like, I can't wait to be invisible. I can't wait to be the last person anyone looks at. And I can't wait to fucking, I just let it all out. I think the difference now is we care less about fitting into this world that has kind of pushed us out, because we're like, you know what? We're gonna make our own now. And we really don't care what you think of us. There's a, I'm seeing a lot of that on TikTok, a lot of sort of like young women, men coming up to them to like talk or whatever, and them just scratching their crotch or being like, yeah, or doing something completely crazy and scary, and the men just like run away. And I'm like, that's what I'm talking about. That's the new
I like
world.
it. I
Anyway,
like it. No, I
thank
like
you
it.
so much.
I
Thank you
love
so
talking to you,
much for, oh, I
Jennifer.
love talking to you too. And thank you so much for making the time while you're on the road. And I'll have all your information down below. When are you back in town? When is your tour
Oh
finished?
my God, I'm coming back in 2 nights.
Oh, yay.
Yeah,
Oh,
it's over. This is the end of it. So
awesome.
I'm looking forward to it. When
Yeah.
I
And
leave, I
I'll
go, can't
definitely,
wait to leave. And when I come back, I'm like, can't wait to go back. So.
I hear you. Thank you so much. I again, thank you.
Hey, Dorian, thank you.